Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters in Islam, welcome to this episode. We thank Almighty Allah who has made it possible for us to reach the month of Ramadan. We pray that may He accept all our righteous actions in this holy month as an act of ibadah. So, inshallah, what I want to do is I'll be taking a book that is one of the very important books that there is no Muslim that calls himself a Muslim that should not at least have heard of this book. It's a very important book that there is no, whatever you call yourself, there is no sect that does not, you know, accept this book as a good book in Islam. It's no other than the book written by Abu Zakariyyah, Yahya ibn Sharf, al Murry and Nawawi, rahimahullah, the Riyadh Us-Saliheen, that is popularly known as the Imam Nawawi. So this book is actually good for several reasons, as we are going to, you know, discuss. There are several reasons why this book is considered one of the best books, you know, that encompasses the life of a Muslim. The thing you need to know about the way of life of a believer is, you know, enshrined in this book. So inshallah, every episode, you know, we are going to be taking one or two ahadith and explain. And I will pray that Almighty Allah SWT will make it, you know, acceptable as an act of ibadah. So if you want to, you know, get a notification each time we make a new episode, you should please subscribe to the channel and also share it with your friends and family. So inshallah, today we are going to be talking about Imam Nawawi's Muqaddima. Muqaddima in Arabic, that is like the preface to a book. So it's very important a lot of the times, especially when it comes to Arabic books, that you read the Muqaddima, because a lot of times the scholars tell you the reasons why they actually wrote this book. It's important to know that most books in Islamic history, most books that were written, were actually, you know, written due to one reason or the other. You'll find that, for example, in Umdat al-Ahkam, there was a reason why the author wrote it. You go to several books of Islam, you see that they are actually, and knowing this reason will actually make you be able to take full benefit of the book. So in the Muqaddima, Imam Nawawi, after praising Allah and sending salutations upon the Prophet Sallam, he says, and this is the first thing he says, I'm a bad. فَقَدْ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْكٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ. He goes direct to quoting the verse where Allah SWT says, I did not create the jinn and mankind except that they should worship me. I do not want from them any provision, nor do I want them to feed me. Now, Imam Nawawi, why did he quote this verse? He went on further to say, وَهَذَا تَصْرِيحٌ بِأَنَّهُمْ خُلِقُوا لِلْعِبَادَةِ. That this verse is a clear indication, it's a clear declaration from Allah that we were not created for anything other than worship. This is the only purpose. And he said that فَحَقٌ عَلَيْهِمْ عَلَيْتِنَاوْ بِمَا خُلِكُوا لَهُ وَالْإِرَادُ عَنْ خُزُوزِ الدُّنْيَا بِالزَّهَادَةِ. And it says his compulsory on us, after knowing this, that everything we do as human beings, everything we do as slaves, should be geared towards this purpose of worship. So that as a Muslim, you don't take any step except that that step is actually going to get you closer to fulfilling this purpose of worship, creation, which is worship. And then he tells us about how the dunya, I'm just going to summarize it, how the dunya is actually a place of, you know, not a place for someone who is intelligent to actually settle down. It's just a place for us to actually end our akhirah. And then he quotes a poet, a very, very important poem that it's actually one of the poems that, you know, it has a lot of deep meaning. So he's لَقَدْ أَحْسَنَ الْقَائِلِ. So it's verily the one who said, and the poet who said this particular, the following statement has actually said well when he said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ عِبَادًا فُطَنَا. إِنَّ لِلَّهِ عِبَادًا فُطَنَا. طَلَّقُ الدُّنْيَا وَخَوْفُ الْفِتَنَا. نَظَرُوا فِيهَا فَلَمَّا عَلِمُوا أَنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ لِلْحَيِّ وَطَنَا. جعلوها لجة واتخذوا صالح الأعمال فيه سفنا. This poem has a lot of deep meaning for one who can reflect. Now, what the poem is saying is that إِنَّ لِلَّهِ عِبَادًا فُطَنَا. Allah has some slaves, some astute slaves, some slaves that are very intelligent, they are very, very wise, and they are very, you know, Allah has blessed them with a lot of wisdom. So what did they do? What did they do with this wisdom? طَلَّقُ الدُّنْيَا وَخَوْفُ الْفِتَنَا. They divorced the world and they feared the temptations in it. Remember what we said before, that Allah only created us for worship. So now these slaves are so wise and they are so intelligent that they know that this is the purpose of, you know, creation. So because of that, they see that the world is nothing but a distraction. The world is nothing, everything in it is designed to distract you from this purpose. So after knowing this, what did they do? Talaku dunya, because they knew that the dunya is going to distract them from fulfilling this project. They divorced the world, and then they feared the temptations in the dunya. Nazaru fiha falamma alimu. How did they arrive at this particular decision of divorcing the world and, you know, only focusing on worship? Nazaru fiha falamma alimu. They looked at the world. They didn't just make that decision. They looked at the world. They studied it. They analyzed it after doing years and years of research, and they came to the conclusion that annaha laysat al-hayy watana. This dunya is not a place for one to establish. This dunya is not a place for one to settle and feel like, yes, I have arrived. Ja'aluha lujjatan. So they took the world as a lujja. Lujja is a wave, like when you're in the sea and then there are waves always, you know, rocking the boat from one side to side. So they took the world as lujja, as a wave that is just, you know, coming. Watakhuzu saliha al-amal fiha sufuna. And you know, if you are in the sea and there are waves, you need something to save you from those waves so that you don't drown. So what do they take as this, after the, you know, this metaphorically speaking, they made this world as a lujja, as a wave, and then they took their righteous actions as what? Sufuna, as the ship that they will use in sailing through these waves of the dunya. Look at this very, very, you know, deep meaning in this poem. So this poem is very important for us to always reflect on. So Imam Nawawi is quoting this poet that he's actually said something very, very important for us to think about. Inna lillahi ibadan futana, tallaqu ad-dunya wa khawfu al-fitana, nazaru fiha falamma alimu annaha laysat lil-hayyi watana, ja'aluha lujjatan wa ittakhadhu salih al-a'mali fihi sufuna. It's very important to him. It's just three lines of poetry. And then he goes, if this is the condition of mankind, if this is our condition on this dunya, that yes, we were created for worship, but every other thing in the dunya is distracting you from this very purpose of creation, then it becomes compulsory. He said, فَحَقٌ عَلَى الْمُكَلِّفِ أَنْ يَزْهَبَ بِنَفْسِهِ مَزْهَبَ الْأَخِيَارِ. It becomes compulsory on someone, on a believer, to take himself and to tread the path of the righteous people. وَيَسْلُكُ مَسْلَكَ أُولِي النُّهَى وَالْأَبْصَارِ. And to follow the advice and the wisdom of the righteous people, the wise people, those who were like the person who quoted this poem, like the poem we just quoted, and to follow those kind of wisdom. And that وَيَتَأَحَّبَ لِمَّا أَشَرْتُ إِلَيْهِ وَيَحْتَمَّ النَّبِيِّنَا سَيِّدِ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَالْآخَرِينَ وَيَحْتَمَّ عَفْوًا لِمَّا نَبَّهْتُ عَلَيْهِ. So what he's basically saying is that we should always, like I said, I'm going to summarize the preface, not really be quoting everything. He's basically telling us that after knowing all this, now the righteous person, the wise thinking person, what you can do to save yourself from this lujja, these waves of the dunya that always distract you from your primary purpose, is to seek the path of the righteous, seek the path of the people that have gone before us, and the path of the Prophet ﷺ, his companions, and those who came after him in righteousness. These are the kind of people that we should look at and try to emulate and follow their path. And then he goes on to tell us how he actually wrote this, why he wrote this book. So he said, after all looking at all this, it occurred to him that what he should write a book. He said, فَرَأَيْتُ أَنْ أَجْمَعَ مُخْتَصَرٌ مِنَ الْأَحَادِيثِ الصَّحِيحَةِ مُشْتَمِلًا عَلَى مَا يَكُونُ طَرِيقًا لِصَاحِبِهِ إِلَى الْآخِرَةِ. So if after realizing that this is the primary purpose of creation, which is worship, and there's a lot of distraction from this purpose, he thought that he should write a book that will comprise a lot of authentic ahadith that will do nothing but to fulfill this purpose of, you know, letting us worship Allah and gain the pleasure of Allah into the akhirah. So this is the primary purpose why Imam Nawawi rahimahullah wrote this book, Riyadh Us-Saliheen. And then he said, he ومحصلاً لأدابه الباطنة والظاهرة. He comprised in this book a lot of manners that are both internal and external. And the external and internal acts of worship are comprised in this book. And ahadith that also talk about targib or tarhib, that tells you about Jannah, that tells you about Nar, they make you fear the hellfire, and ahadith that will make you yearn to, you know, enter Al-Jannah. And he said that he did not compile in this book except authentic ahadith. He said, وَأَلْتَزِمُ فِيهَا أَنْ لَا أَذْكُرَ إِلَّا حَدِيثًا صَحِيحًا. And I made it upon myself that I'm not going to mention in this book any narration that is not authentic. So that is why you see all the narrations that were mentioned in Riyadh Us-Saliheen were narrations that are either muttafaqun alayh, which is the highest form of authenticity in hadith, you know, the hadith that was agreed upon by Imam Bukhari and Muslim, or by Bukhari or by Muslim, and very, very authentic hadith. So, and this is one of the reasons why no one in Islam can dispute the authenticity of this book. And why this book is also very good is because, like I said, it comprises almost, it's an all-round, you know, it's not like a book of fiqh that's only like Umdat al-Ahkam. All the hadith there is also about fiqh, or, you know, some book of tawheed that only quotes hadith of tawheed. This is general. It talks about ibadah, tawheed, fiqh, sirah, so many aspects of the life of a Muslim. So that is why this book is so, so important, that there is no Muslim that should not try to, you know, learn this book. So this is the preface of Imam Nawawi rahimahullah, and then he ends it with a prayer by saying, wa arju an tamma hadha al-kitabu an yakuna sa'iqan lil-mu'tani bihi ila al-khayrat hajizan lahu an anwa' al-qaba'ih al-muhlikat wal-muhlikat wa ana sa'ilu akhan intafa bi shay'in minhu an yad'u li wa liwalidayya wa mashayikhi wa sa'ir ahbabina wal-muslimin ajma'in وعلى الله الكريم اعتمادي وإليه تفويدي واستنادي وحسبي الله ونعم الوكيل ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العزيز الحكيم. So Imam Nawawi rahimahullah, he ends this preface, this introduction to the book, by saying, I pray and I seek, you know, and I hope for the completion of this book, and that this book should be something that, you know, drives people to all forms of goodness and prevents them from all forms of harm and evil. And also, Imam Nawawi is now asking us, I'm asking anyone, any of my Muslim brethren that reads and benefits from this book, and yadu ali, that they should pray for me, wali walidayya, and my parents and my scholars and all my loved ones, and that they should pray for all the Muslims generally. Wallahi al-karim itimadi, and then I put all my hope and all my trust on Allah, and He is the one that I have, you know, relent all my affairs to. Wa hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakeel, and Allah is sufficient for me, and what a wonderful disposal of affairs. Wala hawla wala quwwata illa billahi al-aziz al-hakim, and there is no might or power except with Allah, the most mighty, the most wise. So this is how Imam Nawawi ends his preface, and this is where we are going to stop today. Inshallah, on the next episode we are going to start the book with باب الإخلاص وإحضار النية في جميع الأعمال والأقوال والأحوال البارزة والخضية. And then we'll start taking the hadith. Now, what makes this book also so very, very good is the methodology in which Imam Nawawi, you know, writes it. You see that each chapter he starts, you start by quoting the ayat of the Quran that support that chapter, and then he will start by mentioning the ahadith. And very, very few times will you see his comment in the book. And this is not just peculiar to this book alone. Most of the books of Imam Nawawi rahimahullah, if you read his books, about this is how he writes. There's a book he wrote, Adabu Hamlat al-Quran. It's one of the books I was reading, and I was like, it's really, you know, you would hardly see his statement. That's what I'm trying to say. Any point he's making, he's quoting verses, quoting hadiths, quoting verses, you know, you would hardly, in a page, you hardly see maybe one sentence or two sentences that is actually his own statement. And this is why Imam Nawawi was such a very prolific writer. And this is why his works were so widely accepted in the Muslim. So I pray that Almighty Allah SWT is going to accept this from us as an act of ibadah. And inshallah, we are in the next episode, I'm going to go to the first chapter of the book. So make sure you subscribe so that you can click the notification bell so that you get a notification when we, you know, release the next episode. Salatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsan ila yawmiddin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.